The highly anticipated launch of Starship S-33's heat shield tiles and metal debris has finally arrived. SpaceX is currently struggling with a huge workload, including ongoing cooperation with the FAA and troubleshooting issues in the affected area. Next, we'll take a thorough look at the factors that led to the explosion, with a special emphasis on the engine failure. Finally, we'll dive into the fascinating discussion about the future of the Hubble Space Telescope. Let's dive into today's episode of NR Studio. Flight 7 started well, with the B-1 performing its functions flawlessly in the early stages. However, the final stretch of the flight turned into a dramatic and heartbreaking spectacle. The explosion was a sight to behold, with debris soaring through the sky like an incandescent meteor. But it was deeply concerning in terms of its potential consequences for the mission. The immediate aftermath of the explosion was concerned with the location of the debris. Initial assessments suggested that some of the debris may have washed up on the shores of Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic. However, subsequent reports revealed that debris had also appeared along the coastlines of the Turks and Caicos Islands. Initial images showed the discovery of a single heat shield tile along the shoreline. However, recent revelations, accompanied by photos circulating on Reddit, suggest a much larger number of fragments. In a visually striking presentation, a series of fragments are carefully arranged on an elongated table, displaying over 100 fragments of varying dimensions and configurations. Among them are no fewer than 2 complete tiles. Additionally, there have been reports of the discovery of metal fragments from the Starship S-33 on the islands, prompting locals to actively search for fragments. The Turks and Caicos Islands government subsequently issued a warning, urging residents to refrain from engaging with these materials due to the safety risks involved. In this context, it is likely that the fragments observed represent only a small portion of the total. These are just the fragments that have washed up on the shore, while many others likely drifted out to sea, unharvested. The local government has taken steps to address this issue. In an official communique, Delaney Daniel Silverotnam, the governor of the Turks and Caicos Islands, expressed his concerns. Like numerous individuals throughout the Turks and Caicos Islands, I share the apprehension instigated by the appearance of debris and vibrant hues in the sky last evening. The FAA had previously cautioned about the potential fallout, predicting that debris could extend beyond the designated hazard zone. Nevertheless, SpaceX asserted that Starship was adhering to its intended trajectory, despite conveying a degree of uncertainty in their updates. In light of these developments, the FAA has initiated a formal investigation into the mishap. On January 16th, the agency disseminated an announcement through X, stipulating that SpaceX must conduct an inquiry into the loss of Starship during its Flight 7. Musk has established a provisional timeline of February for Flight 8. However, this schedule is subject to change due to the ongoing investigation. In the forthcoming weeks, SpaceX must undertake several pivotal tasks, which encompass verifying debris locations in impacted areas, determining the underlying cause of the incident, and enacting necessary corrective actions. Notwithstanding these hurdles, there exists a silver lining. The incident resulted in no reported injuries. According to the FAA's official website, there have been no reported injuries to the public. The FAA is currently collaborating with SpaceX and relevant authorities to verify claims of damage to public property in Turks and Caicos. In a similar vein, the National Security Secretariat of the Turks and Caicos government has disclosed that, as of now, there are no reported injuries, and damage to property has been characterized as minimal. These favorable developments, alongside SpaceX's esteemed efficiency and the FAA's accelerated progress under its new leadership, indicate that the challenges may be addressed in a timely manner. Even Bill Nelson, the former administrator of NASA, emphasized the significance of testing in his congratulatory message to SpaceX following the flight. Flight 7 represented a significant advancement for SpaceX, unveiling a variety of novel enhancements and testing goals. This mission marked the inaugural deployment of the V2 Starship, or version 2, which incorporated substantial advancements in the heat shield for the flaps and the payload deployment systems. Noteworthy were the alterations made to the heat shield. SpaceX exhibited enhancements to the metallic heat shield and active cooling systems, having removed tiles in specific regions during the pre-flight broadcast. SpaceX subsequently verified that the systems exhibited commendable performance regarding adherence throughout the flight. Nevertheless, their actual prowess, particularly in pivotal moments like reentry, has yet to be thoroughly evaluated. This highlights the imperative nature of advancing with Flight 8 to authenticate these enhancements and ensure they align with SpaceX's ambitious objectives. As we contemplate the future, a pivotal inquiry persists. Will SpaceX and the FAA successfully navigate the existing challenges to facilitate Flight 8 next month? The resolution of this matter hinges on the swift and adept handling of the repercussions, rectification of technical deficiencies, and the execution of requisite enhancements. What are your thoughts on this matter? Do you believe these challenges will be resolved in time for the scheduled launch of Flight 8? We invite you to express your opinions by responding with a simple yes or no in the comments section below. Additionally, please remember to like the video and subscribe to our channel to remain informed about SpaceX pioneering endeavors. In conjunction with the examination and rectification of the heat shield concern, SpaceX is required to tackle additional underlying factors that played a role in the failure of Flight 7. A notable area of concern pertains to the engines. Throughout this mission, the Super Heavy booster demonstrated commendable performance. However, the challenges associated with the ship's engines became progressively evident. To acquire a more profound understanding of these issues, the significant analyses conducted by Space Engineer and VBS Space have proven to be indispensable. Their comprehensive visuals and analyses have illuminated the chronology of events that culminated in the incident. A profound appreciation is extended to these teams for their diligent efforts. Should you not have done so already, I encourage you to follow them for additional captivating updates and insights. The initial indications of distress surfaced at T+7:39, marked by the failure of one of the vessel's sea-level engines. Musk had previously expressed apprehensions regarding oxygen leaks, which were likely factors contributing to the engine's malfunction. This complication led to a deficient supply of fuel to the engine. Compounding the issue, the oxygen leak exacerbated the pressure within the cavity above the ship engine firewall, thereby potentially paving the way for additional complications. At T+7:52, a fire was detected in the hinge of the starboard aft flap on the vessel. This conflagration, combined with the oxygen leak, precipitated a significant reduction in fuel levels. Shortly thereafter, at T+8:02, a second sea-level engine on the same side experienced a malfunction. A mere second later, a nearby vacuum engine similarly ceased operation. The series of malfunctions persisted as the second vacuum engine ceased operation at T+8:17, subsequently succeeded by the termination of the final sea-level Raptor engine at T+8:23. The sequence and locations of the cascading engine failures, coupled with their atypical nature, resulted in a substantial disparity in thrust. This imbalance compelled the vessel to diverge from its intended course, resulting in a rotation rather than a stable trajectory. Confronted with the circumstances, SpaceX engaged the flight termination system, a conclusion substantiated by the sudden cessation of speed and altitude metrics. Numerous analysts posit that the underlying cause of these failures could be attributed to an obstruction within the liquid oxygen tank, potentially resulting from the formation and accumulation of ice. Such a blockage might have elevated pressure levels, thereby compromising the integrity of the pipes and precipitating the oxygen leak. Although this theory has yet to be substantiated, further insights from SpaceX are anticipated to elucidate the matter. These findings will inform the requisite enhancements for Flight 8, which is currently in the testing phase. Further insights into the behavior of the Super Heavy during hot staging were gleaned from additional observations provided by the space engineer. During the flight, a segment of the booster was released, and an analysis of its trajectory indicates that it descended at a greater distance from the shore in comparison to the apex of Booster 12. This component is expected to be retrieved shortly for examination at Starbase. In our latest update, we report that the Hubble Space Telescope is encountering considerable difficulties due to budgetary reductions. During the 25th convening of the American Astronomical Society on January 1st, the 18th, delegates from the Space Telescope Science Institute elucidated the potential ramifications of diminished funding on the operations of the Hubble Space Telescope. NASA has asked the Institute to develop a Hubble operations strategy for the period 2026 to 2029, constrained by an annual budget of $83 million to $87.8 million, representing a 20% reduction in existing operating funding. This request has raised concerns, as it could significantly impact Hubble's efficiency and jeopardize related scientific initiatives. Julia Roman Duval, acting head of the Institute's Hubble Space Telescope Mission Office, characterized the challenge as nearly insurmountable. She explained that reduced funding would limit the operational capabilities of certain instrument modes, hamper research efforts, and require workforce reductions. The presence of these staff members is critical to identifying and resolving anomalies and unforeseen problems. Their absence would therefore increase the overall risk to the Hubble mission. NASA's proposed budget allocation for the Hubble Space Telescope in 2025 is $89 million, prompting deliberations on necessary modifications. Julia Roman Duval emphasized that the strategy is designed to delay irreversible changes until greater insight is gained into the long-term budget projections. Meanwhile, the Institute anticipates submitting its proposal to NASA in February, hoping to secure additional funding to maintain Hubble's operational capabilities. Over the past decade, Hubble's annual budget has averaged $98.3 million, though it recently dropped to $93.8 million. Inflation has put significant pressure on NASA's overall budget, making it difficult to allocate funds for the telescope, which currently operates in single gyroscopic mode due to underlying technical challenges. While there is some optimism about Hubble's capacity to operate through 2030, its future remains shrouded in uncertainty. Jennifer Lotz, director of the Space Telescope Science Institute, articulated her optimism for increased funding. However, NASA faces a challenging decision as Hubble's budget impacts other initiatives, most notably the James Webb Space Telescope. Hubble's enduring legacy, marked by many transformative discoveries and iconic images, highlights its significance as a critical link between historical achievement and prospective progress in astronomy. The discourse surrounding Hubble's future raises important questions. Should NASA maintain its funding, reallocate resources, or emphasize a transition to advanced technologies? What do you think? That's it for today's episode. See you next time.